Got it. Okay, now we're recording.
We were on number one. Sorry about that.
Oh, no, I'm glad you told me. Okay, so, excuse me. So let's take a look at number one. Connections and trust will need to be our priority. So safety and connection as we move back. We talked about that this morning. So we need to really look at how we begin the minute students walk into our class or meet us virtually. But if we are face-to-face, what, now think about this, what props, what fictional characters, funny hats, pieces of clothing or objects could you bring in to introduce yourself? What things do you love? Like for me, I'm gonna come into my fourth grade class and I'm gonna bring in my big plastic brain. I'm gonna bring in my flip-flops and I'm gonna show them pictures of Nellie, our rescue dog. Because what happens is they begin, that's healthy distraction from the mask. And I'm gonna be immediately making associations and connections with them that yes, the mask is gonna be unfamiliar and it could be scary for some of our kids, but they're gonna get to know me through that mask. So then we model that. And we ask the kids, you know, we have a sign-up sheet. So you can bring in, you know, we'll have five people bring in Monday. We'll have, you know, a couple people bring in Wednesday. So this is really going to be important as we meet new kids. Because, I mean, it would be one thing if, and I think some schools are having some time with the kids that they had in March, just to have closure. But for many of us, we're going to be working with new students. The second one is a calming bag. And this is, I mean, I look at, you know, kind of like as a Mary Poppins bag or just, you know, some type of a kind of a repair and recovery bag. You might have some post-its in it, you know, some markers where the kid needs an affirmation or you can draw a smiley face or you can draw, you know, you're doing great or right, you're doing great. Maybe a wrapped peppermint, maybe a pencil, they need something to write with. Maybe it is, again, we'll have to social and physical distance. So think about things that might feel comforting to your kids. Maybe it's a sticker. You know, maybe it's, you know, just something that says to them, it connection, you know, I see you, I hear you, I'm with you. The third one, I want you to really look at routines. It's interesting because we are in a time where we are being called to do school in a new way. And there's not a better time to create new routines than right now. And I wish I had every administrator in the whole country with me on one call. Because what administrators, and that's from the, I wish I had policy leaders with me. Because what we are going to have to focus on is this brain-aligned social and emotional learning. We're going to have to be intentional about creating blocks of time where we are creating environments of safety and connection. The minute the kids walk into our classrooms and when they leave, because there's going to be a lot of angst about, is this going to happen again? And so new routines when we're wearing our masks can lessen the negative implications of those masks. And so I wrote in here, you know, lessen the embarrassment, discomfort, worry, or anxiety about wearing the mask. Many of our students have not had routines and procedures. And the predictability the structure can provide as we calm and co-regulate one another. So the and then the fourth one of this is connection with parents. And I pulled up, I'm gonna show you what I pulled up with connections with parents, because I think it's gonna be really important to build again, that bridge to ease parents' mind. Many parents are, you know, they're nervous about kids coming back. I would be, you know, I mean, I would be. So these are some questions that will really help to build build that trust. And I'll go through those in just a minute on another form that I can send to you. We did this over the summer and it's using our masks as superpowers. So what we did was, we did this with adults. Everybody brought a mask to the Zoom meeting. And everybody put a mask on during our Zoom meeting. And then we had everybody create a power pose. And when you created your power pose, you had to, in your pose, you took three deep breaths. And as you breathed in, you took four, like a deep inhale, you held it. And then as you exhaled longer and slower, You breathed out a superpower to yourself, to someone that you care about and love, and then you breathed out a superpower to the world. So kids can do that. They can pick one of those. They could do all of those. If I'm a principal of a building, I'm going to be doing this with my staff. There's some really good research on power poses, you know, how they can be calming and regulating for brain states too, that affirmation. So that is a focused attention practice that I talked about this morning that becomes a part of our routine and our procedures. So the other one is using these morning meeting discussion questions, and you can use, just modify them for older students. Like, how does a mask protect us? How did it feel? You know, how has it felt to you having to wear a mask when you leave the house, or have you? How does the mask keep you safe? What are, you know, again, for older kids, it would be a great debate topic, kind of an, you know, like create your infomercial, you know, what do you, you know, maybe create why you think masks are important, why you think that they take away some freedoms. So, and for younger kids, I love my mask because it's magical, has superpowers. Do you know of any superheroes who wear masks? Maybe we could all decorate our masks. And then the last thing is really, one more thing I haven't added yet, but thinking about theme weeks. Again, we're gonna have to really redo our routines anyway. So what about thinking about my favorite color week as we wear masks, or an animal week, or family tradition, favorite traditions? This is an inclusive cultural touch point too, because, you know, Reagan, my daughter and I were talking last night, this calls for a new lens to address anti-racism in our school. So can we begin to ask kids to bring in their traditions, to bring in family routines, to bring in some of their culture? Let's learn about it. You know, let's bring it in so that we can openly talk about it and discuss it. Our favorite poems, our maybe song week, where we bring in songs and why they're meaningful to us. Artist week, we talked this morning about how important it's gonna be. Art is therapeutic. When you draw, when you journal, when you scribble, those are real therapeutic practices. So having a mural, a classroom mural, having, you know, what could you build together? So architect week, brain week, music week, my buddy week. So the last one that I haven't put on here before I send this to Edutopia is everybody puts their masks on in a morning meeting, or even at our desks, because we're not going to be sitting close to each other. And somebody turns around and you make an emotional face and see if we can guess what that feeling is. Because we tell the kids, and we're going to share this research with them, you read people from the eyes up. We don't read from the nose down. Now, for people that are hearing impaired, and that, you know, that's going to be a real challenge. I think face shields are going to have to be an option. So here's something else. Our children on the spectrum are going to struggle too, and sensory processing disorders, that mask is going to feel like a piece of poop on them. And so how are you going to keep them on? So I think we've got to experiment with texture. And we start with, you know, letting them feel something, different textures, and maybe start on the hand and go up the arm. And then, you know, maybe right here, maybe on the shoulder. Let them slowly experience. I don't know what the protocol is going to be as far as, is everyone going to have the same mask, or are people going to be bringing their, I know schools will probably provide one mask, but then, you know, how, you know, what works best? Like, what is a sensory repairing fabric that would be helpful? That's just, you know, just these things I keep thinking about every day. So I'm going to add the one about guessing your facial expression, but that this will be an important one, you know, for us to look at. Does anybody have any comments or thoughts about this?
Lori, one question we had from Christina, and I responded, but I'd love to hear your thought. She's a middle school student, so how can she tailor it to that? I like the idea of themes, but don't want to put pressure on students and parents to have to come up with something new each week. And I also have heard, what I put in there was, I heard on a webinar having the students do a research project about other times we have to wear masks. So surgery, nail salons, delivery room, all those types of things, and kind of weighing in on why and how that's helped them. Or to even take it further, I heard them say about doing like social distancing. So thinking about your astronauts or people who go to Antarctica to do research, why do they go there by themselves, and kind of just weighing pros and cons on that. So I don't know if you have anything to add. And then I also, another question is that elementary music classroom.
Well, that is that is going to be a challenge. Because choral singing, I mean, singing, you know, creates more spittle. And yet it's such a paradise because choral singing is regulating to the nervous system. But that's going to, as music teachers, I would love to talk with music, just have a music teacher session, because we're going to need to be humming. We're going to need to be listening to music. We're going to need to use body rhythms. We're going to need to, that drumming is going to be really important, and you don't have to have drums for that. You can use your lap. You can use, you know, red cups. You can use, and maybe not red cups. I mean, but we're going to have to really, this is why I think this is going to be an excellent time. And I love your suggestions, Christy. The other thing that I encourage middle and high school students to look at are the countries that wear masks on a regular basis. My daughter is living in South Korea right now. And when there's no pandemic, people wear masks. It is considered a part of their health protocol. So now with the pandemic, they've had to take extra measures. They've had to, you know, social distance. They've done all of the things that, you know, every other country has had to do. But I mean, I would really, it would be a great time to study cultures and to study, you know, what's beneath that. So that's a great question. Does anybody else have any questions?
The only other question is just getting the links to the resource. So I don't know if you're going to share that, Lori, or if you want me to put up the slide that you sent me with the MTSS chart.
Yeah, so what we'll do is we're going to put the MTSS chart up. This you guys are seeing this right now, and I haven't even finished the article. But everything I share with you today, I'll send to Christy. And this will be in the MTSS too. So this will be in the AEN MTSS chart.
Awesome. So Sandra mentioned, which is correct, that Riley did release a bunch. We had a webinar with them yesterday, and they shared some music, some dance, some art therapy options. So I think Lisa Truitt's on here. If Lisa, if you could put that in there, Riley Children's Hospital, if you could put that in there for the resources, that would be awesome. If not, I'll get to it here in a moment and add that. Thanks, Sandra, for bringing that up.
Yeah, that's awesome. Please do share, yeah, any resources that you have will be so, I mean, those will be so important. A couple of things that I did not share this morning, and this, again, is brand new, and I want you to have this. And so I'm going to be sending these separately to Christy, because we haven't put them in the MTSS. I mean, that's literally, I have been writing a book during this time, and I said this morning, and I've had to submit the manuscript and then take it back and then resubmit it, take it back and resubmit it because of COVID and because of racism being so highlighted, because there's been a lot of change, and the racism piece is good change. So not how it happened, but I mean, this is now, we are in a new time. So one of the things that I want to share with you today is I would love to see every educator fill this out by choice to let your schools know how you're doing. This is a survey for your staff, and it is looking at during the viruses of racism and the pandemic, how have we, the adults, been doing during this time? Because we know a dysregulated staff, there's contagion, and we will have dysregulated students. That contagion is powerful. So these are very, there's only, I think, 10 or 15 questions, and they're not intrusive. It's always a choice to explain. So my relationships and connections with others during this time have been and are present and healthy, even with physical distancing. Have I felt or am I feeling physiologically safe in this time? Have I felt or am I emotionally safe in this time? Do I have the physiological needs like sleep, food, and housing security I require? Do I have emotional and mental supports I require? And do I have the material resources I require? Am I confidently able to share the resources, emotional, material, and social, I need to support my students in the classroom? So you can go through these. I'm not going to read all. And then there are a few open-ended ones. What are two? These are really important as we look at these. What are two or three of the most significant challenges or worries you have faced or will face when school resumes? And what have been your greatest strengths during this challenging time? How have these viruses personally affected you and or your family in this time? So we're going to take a minute right now, and I want you to look at these. I want you to look at these questions, and I want everybody to pick one. And I want you to really go within for just a minute, and I want you to draw it. Give it a sensation. Give it lines. Give it color. Give it shape. Or just journal. Pick one of these questions, and this is what I'm modeling for you right now, is how we can begin our days with these new routines that are brain aligned, and they are focusing on connection and attachment. If you know, people will say, Lori, I'm an SEL trainer. Well, what are we training? We're really looking at these facets of educational neuroscience. We're talking about safety and trust and connection and emotional and physiological well-being. And those are all aligned with where we are functioning in brain state. So I'm gonna give you just 2 minutes. And I want you just to draw it, give it an image, color, shape. About 30 more seconds. Some of the most prolific and oldest research in the resiliency research shares that the difference between a good teacher and one that is superior is one that is self-reflective. And I think that's really true for us in all moments, but I think it's going to be really, really important for us to think about as we move into this unknown time. Because as I mentioned this morning, we've got the three conditions that every one of those ACEs, adverse childhood experiences, address. And that's chronic unpredictability, isolation, and physical and emotional restraint. And so those conditions have hit us all in our homes and in our lives. So I would love for three people to unmute, and if you would share the question that you chose and maybe hold up an image that you drew or just share what your journaling was. I would be so grateful.
Hi, Lori, it's Betsy. I'll go.
Hi, Betsy.
The question about how it's affected me and my family. And I drew our three houses and big X's between them and put the word poison underneath because I feel like I can't be with my kids and that we're poison to each other.
Wow. I mean, I think about it. No, I mean, I felt that way with my mom. You know, and even a little bit when Reagan came home from Chicago the first time. I mean, these are our family members. And, you know, we want to keep our parents safe. We want to keep each other safe. And it just feels unnatural. Betsy, thank you for sharing that. Anybody else?
I can share mine.
Thank you so much. Hi, Amber.
I'm not an artist, but here's my little drawing of
mine. I'm not either.
I chose the professional one because, you know, while there's been a lot of challenges and anxiety, I also feel like I've had a lot of time to read and just do professional development, just gain as much knowledge as I can to try to tackle the school year.
That's awesome. So again, we talked about that this morning, Amber. That's a great example of that perspective shift. You know, too, where, I mean, it's been a hard time, but it's also been a time where you've been able to, you know, really learn and take in some of the research and knowledge and the application of that. Thank you. One more. Anybody else?
Hi, I'm Alana. I'll share.
Thank you. Hi, Alana.
I'm an administrator, and I chose the first one, and I just kind of made a pie with lots and lots of slices, and I just feel overwhelmed with all the things I'm responsible for and how I'm going to manage it all.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you for sharing that. I can't imagine. I mean, it is overwhelming. And so I appreciate you sharing that. And one of the things that I want you to think, whether you are a teacher, a school psychologist, a school counselor, therapist, whatever your role, school nurse, administrator, I want you to really think today as we go through this, you know, just prioritize what you feel is going to be the most significant for your staff, for your colleagues, for your students, if you're a teacher. You know, where, because there's, we can begin, and to go slow is to go well. And so, you know, I want you to really think about, don't, you know, it's hard not to get overwhelmed with all of what we, you know, with the responsibilities that we have. But, you know, I just want you to pick, you know, just kind of choose and maybe just focus on one or two things as we reenter. So thank you. Anybody else? All right, I'm going to go ahead and share back. And I'm going to pull up one more here. So this is also a piece that I'm working on for Edutopia. And it's called Imagine in this Time of Education. So looking at these viruses and looking at what we have all experienced, this is collectively. So think about, what if we as a school, what if we as a grade level, what if we as a department, or what if we as a team based on the science, what if we intentionally created 5 to 10 minutes every morning and at the end of the day for an all school focused attention practice? It would look different in different classrooms, but this week I've been working with educators in New Jersey, and we've been talking about how collectively this is good for all of us. So whether some of us put music on and everyone is just sitting quietly listening to music, whether some of us are doing 10 seconds of deep breathing, whether some of us are focusing on the taste of a mint, you'll have lots of strategies for focused attention practices, but could we do that as a school? I think that's just going to be a game changer. What if we were given as a staff a positive aspects journal to write in this school year? I don't think, we know that a journal or journaling is a touch point. We know that it's connection. So touch points aren't always people, but what if we all had some type of a bullet journal or a journal, and we were given that time just for 2 minutes, just to write down thoughts, to write down observations. What you can name, you can lessen. What you can share, you can bear. What if the staff scheduled all of us in our building a 15-minute therapeutic/counseling session once a week with a trusted colleague? So we don't have enough school counselors. I said this morning. We don't have those resources, but we have each other, and having each other doesn't cost money. So what if we were intentional right now about setting up time and scheduling that time, making sure that we all have somebody in those first few weeks of school that we can attune to as often as we need for questioning, for validating, you know, for brainstorming, and for sharing. What if we were intentional about reaching out to our communities for volunteers who could share their expertise in a variety of regulatory practices? And all, some of you mentioned Riley Hospital's resources. This is a form of that. You know, this is the time where we can, people love to help in schools. People love to serve. It's a vocation. So, you know, what type of yoga teachers can we bring in? What can we do with music since we're not going to be singing? What can we do with art and meditation and exercise? And how can we cultivate climates of racial equity also by bringing in community members who can begin to share their expertise and their passions and, you know, and a particular skill or information and research? What if we shared in a communion ritual every week in our school? This is an embodied experience. This literally quiets the nervous system. Sharing a bottle of water in the morning with someone as you come in. Having, you know, just a snack time for your staff once a week. Making sure as a building that we are creating rituals of connection. Again, this doesn't have to be added to what you're all, I don't want you to think of this as an added extra, but as a way to create those conditions the brain must have for learning, safety and connection. And what if we, many schools are doing this right now, had a regulatory amygdala area for staff to use when they are needing a few minutes? And I see, I was working with North Allen Community Schools, and we talked a lot about this, not only setting up an amygdala area, but scheduling time for staff to go in there and use it, to be intentional about that. With these practices for the adults in the building, our students will follow our lead. There will be heightened emotions from educators, parents, and students upon our return. When the adults in the building are intentionally caring for themselves and one another, the students will sense and feel that nonverbally. And we talked this morning that our communication is, you know, is nonverbal. I mean, we are, you know, we are reading each other perfectly through postures, gestures, tone, and vocal expressions. So I wanted to also share with you, those of you, this is really important science for us right now, and it really explains the triggered behaviors you see in the classroom. And bear with me for a minute. I'm going to skip over some of this, and I'm going to show you these two pathways in the brain. And this is really just so relevant for us. So we know that our brains are built from the very back to the front. So we've got the brain stem down in here. You can see it under the cerebellum. And then deep, I can use my mouse here, and then deep in this limbic area that I'm circling right here, this is your, the limbic system is your, it's your threat detection center. It's your emotional processing center. It's not negative or positive. It actually is not just about negative emotion. All emotion is registered and encoded. If it's important enough, it's encoded in this area, but it is your brain's smoke detector. And so the reptilian brain is our oldest ancient brain. And this part of the brain is the seat of everything we do autonomically. It's where we have digestion and our sleep rhythms and we breathe. And it also is the seat of where the stress response begins. So I used this morning, if I screamed right now as loud as I could into my computer, you guys, many of you, your hearts would start to beat, or you would have, your heart would beat and you would jump back, or your body would contract. And that's what happens. So we see our heart rate increases when there is adversity. our body contracts, which is moving up into midbrain areas. Then we have a feeling, you'd be afraid for a minute. And then you could put words to that. But many of our kids are coming in and they have what we call, they take the low road pathway. And so the low road pathway is when a stimulus comes in and it goes to the thalamus, which is kind of like, you don't have to know all this. This is kind of like our relay station. And then the thalamus says, this is important enough to have a response, a reaction to. And so immediately there is an emotional reaction. And so the short pathway, it goes right to the amygdala. So it comes in from the brainstem, goes to the thalamus. You can see this black arrow goes right to the amygdala and boom, a kid is running out of the room. A kid is throwing a book across. Somebody else is completely shut down. And that child is locked in this lower, it's called a thalamic pathway. And then we have a different response. And that is when we have a stimulus that comes in. And remember, a stimulus can be outside of us or it can be internal. How many of you have been going along and doing something? Have you ever gotten vertigo? Has anyone ever had vertigo? Yes?
Yes. Terrible.
Yeah. Okay, that's an internal stimulus. Or all of a sudden you've gotten stomach cramps in the middle of a presentation. Or you're presenting and all of a sudden, how many of you have been so nervous your mouth loses all of its saliva? I mean, literally, it's gone. And so what we know is that that stimulus can be internal and we still, then our heart beats and then we react bodily and it goes to the thalamus and then we have this fearful feeling. It goes right, that's the low road. Now, if we've had vertigo before or if we've ever been speaking, public speaking is a huge fear. So if we've ever been speaking before and our mouth goes dry, we know in both those situations, the brain predicts from previous experiences. So if that's happened to us before and we've been okay, then that pathway is called the cortical pathway and it moves to the frontal lobes. And we reason it out. We'd say, okay, you know, damn it, I've got vertigo again. I know I'm not gonna die from this. Or damn it, I need to put Vaseline on my lips or get a drink of water right now. You know, my mouth is dried up. So this is really important for us to understand because many of our children, and I said this morning, if you're not exposed to experiences of kindness, your brain doesn't develop the circuits for kindness. If you're not exposed to empathy, your brain does not develop the circuits for empathy or regulation. When you don't have those experiences to compare and contrast, that's when we see this reactive amygdala. And it's called the low road. And we know, and this is really interesting, Joseph Ledoux's research, I love. Like, I have such a crush on him. I love his work. And an intellectual crush. And so he talks about how we have a fast road from the limbic system to the cortex. You know, that pathway from the limbic brain to the cortex is wired so that we can feel something and immediately have access to words, or we can know it's going to be okay. We can also have a reaction in this lower region where the cortex isn't invited. So the information never gets to the cortex. And so what happens is, it's kind of like, think about like falling off a chair. You're a big 6'6" person and you fall off a chair and it happens quick. So that's like the fast pathway. So your thalamus to amygdala or thalamus to cortex. And then how much longer does it take you to get your big body back on that chair? So think of our kids who really don't have the experiences. And what Joseph Ledoux says, we don't have neurobiologically a fast pathway back to the amygdala. We have a fast pathway from the amygdala to the cortex when we invite the cortex on, but from the cortex back to the amygdala, it's slow. And it's like if you're holding a cup of marbles and you dump them, it takes 1 second. Now think about how long it takes to pick them all up. And so the brain does not have, it's not wired. The cortex is the newest part of the brain. It's not the emotional ancient system. And it's really about cognition. So that pathway back and forth to the amygdala is neurobiologically slower, and it's just not evolved yet. It's Dr. Joseph Ledoux says it confuses him, and he knows more about the amygdala than any human in the world. But basically what we know is many of our kids can't reach the cortex. They get lodged or stuck in the limbic midbrain and brainstem areas. This is the survival response. And this is the response of the social engagement system. This is a cortical response. So, and I'll be happy to send this. I use this in our certification. It kind of shares about the incoming signals and what the brain, so I've kind of talked with you about that. But it's really important for us to look at that as we go through this work. So
I'm going to- There was one question that was relevant to what you're talking about. So from Jennifer.
Yes, please do.
Would this internal stimulus that you're talking about be the same as interception? I don't know exactly what she was reflecting back on. So Jennifer, if you want to unmute and ask, feel free to.
Yeah, please. Yeah, I'd like to hear more. Like, what do you mean exactly?
Hi, are you there?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Mm-hmm. Hi, I've learned through my own child, especially all those internal sensations that the signals are all messed up and crossed. And so whether it be the bowels, all the internal organs, that interoception of the nervous system that is not acting properly. So the confusion, it could be, you know, maybe their thirst signal, their hunger signals,
absolutely,
all those things are stimulus that, unfortunately, the signals are kind of getting crossed or misinterpreted, you know, where sometimes they don't even get the signals for these basic human things that we don't think about, but for some children, these bodies, especially when sensory processing is such a difficult concept, that these are not innate for them. They just literally don't get those signals, or they get the signals confused. And so would that be that stimulus that you're talking about?
Absolutely. That's the internal stimulus. And it is confusing because many of our kids, so we see this a lot in sensory processing disorders and children on the spectrum and children with trauma. And there's not one reason why this happens. And there's not one way to begin to help that child, to sit with them, to help them organize and integrate those connections in lower brain regions. So I would never, but you're so right. And I'm so glad you brought up that point. So in thinking about trauma and adversity, what happens is, so think about, I just want you to think about a baby, you know, just a newborn baby. And I want you to think about if that baby does not, so when babies are crying, they are communicating. And all communication in the first year of life is right hemisphere to right hemisphere. Yes, right hemisphere to right hemisphere. So let me explain what I mean by this. This is fascinating. We don't have language in the first year of life. And so we are reading, as I said this morning, babies are able to read emotions and sensory information and perceptions right off the bat. They take in their world through sensory and emotional and perceptual experiences. Their brains are developing without language. And so a newborn baby and its caregiver are communicating through touch, through pressure, through rhythm, through gentle eye contact, through the environment. When it's quiet, when there is less noise, and that caregiver is there to co-regulate that child through the sensory world. But what happens when that baby is crying and there's not a caregiver that is there consistently? When we are wet, or when we are hungry, or when we are hurt, we need another human being to hold us, to give us pressure and touch, to rock us. And what happens is when we don't get that co-regulation, and this is not true for all kids, I'm talking about children who come from significant adversity and trauma, but when those pieces are missing, then our sensory and motor systems are not able to integrate in a way that produces that calm portal to this prefrontal cortex. Now, some children are born with heightened activity in those lower brain regions. And it takes a caregiver a long time to help that child to process all the sensory information. Some kids are, they are touch, they're tactily defensive. You know, they are auditory sensitive. So there are many, many reasons, but what's common in all of those is that the brain, the sensory and motor systems are constantly developing. And many of our children who are coming in rough, who are coming in looking sometimes like attention deficit disorder or like attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, they're coming in with the inability to pay attention because their sensory and motor systems are revved up. And I just said that, and I'm gonna shut this door when we take a break in a minute, but there was just a big motorcycle that just revved up right when I said that. So it's a great question. I didn't mean to get in the weeds with that, but the sensory and motor systems of many of our children, that's why we may be working with a 10-year-old in fifth grade. But because of some of the sensory processing challenges and motor challenges and adversity that they have experienced, the emotional age may be half the chronological age. So that's why we've got to attend to the brain state and not the behavior. Gabor Mate has a wonderful, and I'm going to show you guys a video. I love when you give me ideas, and I want to show this to you. Since most of you were with me this morning, I want to show this to you in just a minute. Gabor Mate works with adversity and trauma and addiction. And he speaks about this. He says, children, babies are very open and can feel the pain and suffering in their environments. If the mother is suffering, the baby is suffering too. All connected to physiological illnesses, addiction, feelings of abandonment, loss, an unconscious state, and levels of fear. What kinds of worlds do our kids get? What type of worlds are they bringing into us? Our oldest son, Andrew, came into this world with anxiety that we still cannot figure out, and he's 28 years old. We had temper tantrums. We had pieces of clothing that literally a shirt put on the wrong way would throw him over the edge. He would not ride the bus to school for the first 3 weeks in first grade. Any look, any comment from someone, he was extremely sensitive to how his peers perceived him. He still is as an adult today. And his little nervous system, when he came into this world, it was wired tight. And we know sometimes genetics plays a piece. We know genetics and environment can work together, but we do know that many of our children were seeing pain-based behavior and chronic behavioral challenges, not to excuse them, but to understand that these are sensory and motor and regulation issues. All chronic behavioral issues are regulation issues. So it's interesting, when things are chaos in a home, when there is not a lot of emotional availability, or there's not a lot of stability, or there's not a lot of serve and return, children are naturally narcissistic. That's how developmentally, in those early developing years, those preschool, early childhood years, children are that way. So when things go awry in their environments, then they internalize that as they're the cause. And so we see kids coming in, sometimes internalizing that anger. They're shut down. I want to be very clear about something today. Every single caregiver, every single guardian and parent, and I'm going to say parent, They are doing the best they can in the moment they can. And I think we have to move away from, you know, looking at, oh my God, you know, what's going on in this home? I'm learning every day. And I just want us to be very, very aware of that I think every parent, we know trauma is generational. Trauma is intergenerational. It's institutional. It is historical. There's community trauma. And there's just, that's why The Pair of Aces by Wendy Ellis, her research is so important. And I have that in one of the documents in the MTSS. So we need to understand that, you know, community ACEs and food insecurity, housing insecurity, all of those, poverty, all of those play in to many of the adversities that we all carry into our places of work. And I want to, as we move into this framework today, and this is the old version of this, I want to share with you, this was from the Department of Ed, Indiana's Department of Ed. And I just want us to take a look at this statement. I didn't show this morning. Let me make this bigger on the slideshow. So according to the Indiana Department of Education, MTSS is defined as an educationally equitable, that's an important word, framework, characterized by a continuum of evidence-based practices for academics, behavior, and social and emotional development. MTSS has a multi-tiered system to meet the needs of all students. The focus of the MTSS is to identify social and emotional and behavioral wellness needs, along with the academic needs to focus on the whole child. So as we look at this, and again, I showed this morning, when you start with the science, when you look at brain development, when you look at how our systems develop, when you look at how adversity affects development, when you look at the resiliency research, and when you look at these four pillars under educational neuroscience, my brain and body state, connection, regulation, co-regulation, and teaching our kids about their neuroanatomy, that's social and emotional learning. That's operationalizing social and emotional learning. Before this pandemic, and then we'll take 3 minutes so you can stretch and get water like we did this morning, 3 or 4 minutes, and then we're gonna come back and delve into the template again. So taking a look at our rankings right now, we're struggling in Indiana, like many states. We saw New Jersey's this week, but for each indicator, higher ranking represents better outcomes for youth. So our foster care, we are 47th in foster care, 48th in child maltreatment, 43rd in youth and juvenile detention, 29th living in high poverty, and children adopted through the Indiana Department of Child Services has increased steadily since 2014. This is from the Indiana Youth Institute State of Our Children. 31,000 Hoosier children were in foster care in 2017, a 38.1% increase from 2012. You know, and again, we know that this is highly correlated to many, many facets, but the opioid epidemic and the addiction challenges for us in our communities is a big part of this. So these are statistics that we have to look at, and these graphs are very, you know, very telling, because when you look at adoptions from the DCS, so children adopted through the Indiana Department of Child Services has increased steadily since 2014, and that's new research. Going up since 2017. During the CDC's reported that in early April that the, and I think you all heard this too, domestic violence and sexual and physical abuse has amped up since COVID. And that was reported in early April. 10% of Indiana children have a parent who has served time in jail compared to 7.7% nationally. And the percentage of Hoosier students reporting a parent serving time in jail ranges from a high of 24% to 17.6%. So as we talked about today, we are not looking at disorders, you guys. And this is why I'm so excited that Christy and Jess and the DOE has invited this work in MTSS. We're looking at a reordering of neural networks in the brain. This is a brain that has learned how to survive. These are brains that are functioning to the best of their ability because they are living in a new homeostasis, in a new normal. And these achievement gaps that we are seeing are adversity gaps. But the key, and this is going to be hard for us, is that we have got to drop that mindset that we can push through the academics without taking the time and the research that says you've got to feel safe in an environment or you don't learn. And you've got to feel felt in an environment or you don't learn. So most all negative behaviors arise from a stress response state. Chronic stress affects short-term memory and short circuits and distorts the short-term memory. A dangerous child is a scared child, living from a survival state level brain state. Implicit emotional and procedural memories. We talked a lot about this morning, 11 million bits of information coming in every second that land in the body. Become stuck in the body. I would change this PowerPoint now, in the body and in lower brain regions, especially the right hemisphere. And affect regulation is part of the regulatory system. We are who we are in a large way based on the regulatory relationships with our caregivers. And that's true for all of us. The dyadic failure of affect regulation that serve and return leads to the developmental psychopathology that underlies all later forming psychiatric disorders. This is the research from the slide from Dr. Alan Shore, S-C-H-O-R-E. So children who are misbehaving are seeking external regulation. I'm not talking about once in a while, I'm talking about those kids who are really struggling chronically. Stress has an immediate impact on our unconscious mind, triggering the following. We either live in the past when we're stressed or we're worrying about the future and we're not in class with the teacher. Do you see how important focused attention practices are going to be when we look at where the mind is when we're trying to teach an algorithm, when we're trying to talk about historical subjects, when we're trying to write a persuasive paragraph? So we've got to use brain intervals and focused attention practices to bring that brain back into the present moment. When you have a handful of Pop Rocks and you put them on your tongue and you're asked to just sense what that feels like for 30 seconds, your attention is back in that classroom. I love this quote from Dr. Perry. You cannot change parts of the brain that are not activated. In order to change the brain state, you must activate the state. I have to meet my students where they are, and I can't wait to do that this year. I'll have horrible days and bad days, but I'll have good days too. And so if a kid comes in rough, then I'm going to breathe with them. I'm going to take a walk with them. I'm going to give them the space and the time they need. I'm going to, in a neutral time, talk about what feels calming to them. I'm going to give them some time to listen to music for a minute or to draw or to color. And we teach these ahead of time. This morning, we talked about the relationship between food and eating and relational health. And so I want to mention this too, because hoarding food for kids that have come from some significant adversity is trying so hard to regulate your brain and body. Stealing is the same thing. Now, I'm not talking about kids once in a while. All kids steal and lie. I'm talking about the chronic issues that we see with many children who come from a significant number of adverse childhood experiences. Children lie from a place of life or death, and they must persist with that lie at all costs in order to survive. It's the same thing with manipulation and control. You're going to see kids manipulate and control, and it's going to feel so disrespectful to you. It's going to feel intentional. And what we have to understand, that's a survival brain state. You know, that is, and so, and especially this is, I, as a mom, oh my God, I would have done things so differently. When, and Andrew lied to us all the time. And it, he lied from a place of fear, especially in those adolescent years. And I wish I had ignored the lie right then. And I had focused on his sensations and his feelings, because I can address and teach the lesson later. I was asking him when he was functioning from his amygdala, like we do with our kids. His amygdala is activated. I was asking him, I wanted to say, why the fuck did you lie to me? But I said, why did you lie to me? Why did you lie to me? Look at me, Andrew. And he would pace and not look at me. And what I did was, I didn't realize then that for Andrew to pace, well, he was regulating his own nervous system. That was good for him. I was dysregulated. And when I asked him to look at me when I was talking to him, I was dysregulating him. And when I asked him why he lied, I was literally joining him in his fight flight response. Stealing behaviors are an attempt to self-regulate and calm the nervous system as well. And stealing food can be a self-regulatory behavior. So this morning we talked about how we can, because lunchtime is going to be different, because snack time is going to be different, because we're going to maybe be eating in cohorts or eating with box lunches, wrapped food. We need to rethink how we can create lunchtime or breakfast time in our schools or snack time as a ritual. So go, speaking of, go get your coffee, go get some water, and we'll start up again in 3 or 4 minutes.
Hey, Lori, before we do that really quick, I put in the chat your website, because they were asking about the survey, and I know you already have that and some other COVID resources up there, but we think we've crashed it because now it won't load. So everybody just look in a couple of hours.
Okay, so this is so funny. So this is what happened this week. We're working on getting, is it, what do you say? Do you get more bandwidth? Is that what it is?
I think that's what it's called. I don't know though.
Okay, well, it happened. I did a presentation for the American middle level educators, and I think about 400 people tried to get on at the same time, and I panicked, and I think that's what happened. So try it again.
Yeah, and then I also put up there the video recording that you and one of the Butler Lab schools did about the daily brain reflection charts and the resources there as a good place for people if they're wanting to start some of this. So just wanted to draw attention to that before we go on break.
Oh yeah, and we'll just take a few minutes, just enough to get to the restroom, get some water, because I really, I've got some more strategies. And so is it true that there were only about 2 people that didn't hear me this morning?
That's what I saw was, well, either they heard you this morning or they've heard you previously.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is good. Is this good, you guys? Is this following up from this morning?
Yeah, please put in the chat, and you can send it privately to me if you feel like this is too high, or if you need us. Yeah, send it to me and we'll put some feedback. Oh, we got a perfect already. Okay.
Okay. We'll see you in a few minutes. Okay, we'll start in about 1 minute.
Lori, do you know what grade you'll be doing at Harrison?
I think I'm going to be in fourth grade.
So fun.
Yeah, I think it's fourth. I think fourth and maybe some fifth grade, but I think it's going to be fourth.
That's awesome.
I'm excited. There's Chad. He's on here. Yeah, I believe if you weren't on here this morning, I don't feel like you lost much. I really, you know, we know that trauma is held in the body. And I did a lot of, you know, talk about how that, you know, the brain grows through organization, then disorganization, then reorganization and disorganization. And that's just a natural part of development. And we just are so blessed to have our kids with us so that we can sit beside them in this time. So there's Jennifer. Oh, I'm seeing people I didn't know were on. I didn't even look to see who was on today. And could you speak to the hippocampus? Yes, I'll speak to the hippocampus right now because there's brand new research looking at the hippocampus. I'm gonna share my screen as we come back on here.
And most everybody said that they're on track. They don't feel like they've missed anything. And Sandra, she's on it. Sandra, she wanted us to know your website's back and working so people can check it back out.
Oh, God. Okay, let me see. I texted Nellie, my web designer, for Nellie. I want to share with you in this time together. Let me go to the hippocampus real quick because this has to do with the hippocampus. So you guys, this is the coolest new research. I wanna share this with you. I mentioned this morning about the microglial cells. And so, I want you to think about this. We now know the brain is not immune to inflammation. Our brains have inflammation just like our bodies do. Our, you know, it's that emotional injury. That's when we are stuck, you know, when we are experiencing chronic anxiety. We've all gone through periods of time like this, you know, where, you know, panic attacks, you know, just those, that feeling like this is never going to end, depression. And so what we know is that these microglial cells act as white immune cells, white blood cells, immune cells in the brain. And they actually, they've discovered now that they are literally born in the ninth, I can't believe they can know this, the ninth day of gestation. They travel through the bloodstream into the brain. And so early unpredictable chronic adversity triggers a process of low-grade inflammation within the brain itself. We thought the brain to be immune privileged, but under chronic stress, the brain creates a state of neuroinflammation. These are our rough kids. You know, and I'm going to talk about the hippocampus. So due to non-neuronal cells, the microglia, which they make up a tenth of our brain cells, they play an integral role in pruning brain neurons in development. They do not like chronic unpredictable stress. And when there is chronic unpredictable stress, they go off kilter and they crank out more cortisol, more neurochemicals that lead to the eating away of good synapses. So synapses are connections. They're like little Pac-Men. And microglial cells are good for us under normal, like when we're in a parasympathetic response, because they literally are trash collectors. They take away the debris from the cells. They take away cells that have died that we don't need anymore. And they bring nutrients to cells when we are in a state of regulation. These cells attack the hippocampus area much more so, at least they right now, they see the hippocampus, which is our seahorse structure that is the seat of emotional memory and visual and spatial memory, but we see cell death in the hippocampus. So the hippocampus is this, I said this morning, it's the CEO of our stress response systems. It's supposed to turn off cortisol. But what happens is the receptors in the hippocampi area actually, when cortisol is pouring in, those receptors can't handle it. It's kind of like when you've turned on the tub and the water is overflowing the sink or the bathtub. There's no place for it to go. And so those receptors, those dendrites that are supposed to bind with, they're called glucocorticoid receptors. They're supposed to bind with cortisol to turn it off. They can't. And so what happens is those receptors wither away and we see cell death in the hippocampus area. And this compromises the way kids can remember memory. It happens to adults. My sister-in-law right now, who has probably an ACE score of 10 or 12, is struggling right now with memory issues. And I'm not a neuroscientist, so I don't know, but as I study this work, I told her, I said, this depression that you're experiencing and this memory loss go hand in hand. We know that. And so the good news is that this, the hippocampi area, you have two amygdalae, they can regenerate. Neurogenesis happens in this part of the brain. So the hippocampus can actually create new neurons. We know that, and probably in other parts of the brain too. But I don't know that research, but we do know in this area of the brain that that happens. So when a young child faces emotional adversity or stressors, cells in the brain release a hormone that actually shrink the size. That's what I'm talking about, that there is cell death in that area. And this is where the child processes emotion and memory and manages stress. So the higher the ACE score, the smaller the cerebral gray matter or brain volume in the prefrontal cortex. So this begins to atrophy, and the amygdala and sensory association cortices and cerebellum are affected too. So frontal regions become underactive, making individuals hyperactive to very small stressors. That's kind of our new normal. And as I said this morning, attachment or lack thereof affects our sensory and motor systems. So let me just go through a couple of these points with you this afternoon. And I wanna show you just a 4 minute, just from Dr. Karen Purvis, I just wanna show you this on sensory processing. Many troubled youth have learning difficulties because of an overactivated right hemisphere. When this right brain is constantly activated, you're in this overreactive emotional sensory state and you can't process, you can't get to here. So any type of information not associated with survival is dismissed. So think about that. If you know, that's why no one gives a poop about an algebra problem or, you know, writing these narratives when you can't, when you're focused on survival. Reduced serotonin levels, especially in the belly, leads to more aggression and negative emotion, and I'm gonna add hunger. Trauma is stored in the implicit memory of the right hemisphere and the body, and it's processed visually, and the right hemisphere or right brain holds negative emotion. So we see specific areas of the brain that I've already talked about that are affected by this trauma and adversity. Oops, and I'm gonna show you this too. This is really important here. Repeated and overwhelming stress sensitizes the amygdala and it becomes hyper alert to danger. Troubled children reset their normal level of arousal even when no external threats exist. They are in a persistent state of alarm. So when you think about how the brain literally functions, memories and sounds and flashbacks and the way someone's gray sweatshirt looks on them, the height of an individual, piece of clothing, again, sounds, textures, all of these can trigger a kid and you think, where the hell did that come from? And I wanna say to you, nothing comes from nothing. So we're not excusing the behaviors, but we have to understand that these are implicit, fragmented sensory memories that literally are repressed. And when the brain makes an association subconsciously, then that's when we see sometimes these behaviors that can be so challenging for us. And that's when we see activation in that survival brain state. And this is really a great quote too. Troubled kids are distinguished by their regrettable ability to elicit from others exactly the opposite of what they really need. And here's the crux of why we're together. And I said it this morning, the central challenge facing adults working with children with significant adverse childhood experiences is dealing with their primary pain without inflicting secondary pain through punitive or controlling reactions. We have got to understand that when we yell, nag, threaten, isolate, and send away the same kids over and over again, we are re-traumatizing unintentionally and reactivating their stress response systems. And that's why I'm so grateful to be a part of this research and the application of this research in this time. So I want to show you, I'm going to pull up my folder here. And actually, I got to stop and share, and then I'm going to share again to turn on the volume. So just give me 1 second. And it should be, just give me 1 second here. This is really important. I want you to see this. But I'm not gonna waste too much more time. See, my cortisol is getting higher. Oh, let's see. Here we go.
Sensory processing issues are very, very common in our children. It makes sense when you think about it developmentally. When a parent holds their newborn child, they're touching them, they're cradling, that baby feels the warmth of that parent's hand, the warmth of the parent's body. When I hold my baby against my chest, they feel my heart pounding and thumping gently. When I speak, they feel the vibrations. Matter of fact, I'll often ask parents who are talking to me, just put your hand on your chest and keep talking to me and feel that vibration. Our babies, as they're held and cradled, they feel our warmth. They might taste our milk, the mother's milk. They hear our voice. They see our face. The sensory regions of the brain come alive in that environment. There is a lot of research from 50 years and longer of research with deprivation that shows if children and even any living creature, but if we're not picked up and held, touched, cradled, and nurtured, the brain simply doesn't mature in appropriate regions. There's not synaptic connections. One of the real travesties about that we know as well is if there's a change in the sensory processing, we've got changes in the brain development, also the brain chemistry. So actually children who don't process the senses are now going to be much higher risk to be reactive to senses. So think about, there's 5 external senses. We all think about smell and sight and sound and so forth. But think about the internal senses. So the first internal sense is, it's called vestibular, which is just a big word that means I know where I am in space. When I pick my baby up, the vestibular fluid in the inner ear moves. So that baby knows when I'm being picked up, when they're being picked up, that they're here with me. They were here, now they're here with me. A lot of our kids, if they're swinging or spinning or doing an activity, they don't know where they are in space, and they're thumping into things, they're bumping into things, they're clumsy, they're breaking things, they're not being malicious. But this sense didn't mature. Then for a lot of our children, there's another sense, it's called proprioception. It's just how tightly my muscles register deep touch. Now, for me as a mother, when my child cries, I hold them tighter. If they cry harder, I rock and I hold them tighter. Well, that rocking is the vestibular feedback that gives them calming, and the deep muscle calming when I hold them tighter. Now, though, a child is older, I come to maybe kiss them and I give them a little feathery kiss and they yelp, or they brush off my kiss because they don't know how to interpret the sense of that muscle. I might come to my child as well and give them a hug and they might yelp. But when they give me a hug, they might crush my bones. Are they being bad? No. They're not processing that sense. They don't have the brain development to understand that sense. And the third internal sense is tactile. So most of your sense, your greatest sense organ in your body is touch, is your skin. The first sense that's available that's online in utero for every living creature that we know of is touch. So touch is hugely important. But think about a child who's not touched and cradled carefully. That child is going to be the child who'll have trouble when somebody touches them, knowing if they were hit or touched. That's, again, the child who you give a feathery kiss to, and they don't know how to interpret that, and so they don't want your kiss, they rub it off. The senses, understanding the senses is dramatically important, and we recommend that parents understand it. It is my earnest belief you cannot serve in your home, in your school, in your church, in your nursery, in any environment, you cannot serve an at-risk child unless you understand the sensory processing.
Let me come back up, hold on one sec. Can you all see, I'm back up with the accommodations. Can you see this?
Yep.
Okay. So this is why there is such an emphasis in today's training on the sensory regulatory practices and strategies and creating accommodations for those. And again, I want to emphasize that as a grade level, as a department, as a school, when we are looking and observing our kids who are struggling greatly with behaviors, we've got to, again, activate the state to change the state. And that's what these accommodations are for. And that is why you've been given in this PowerPoint. And when we pull this up from the beginning and we go over to sensory and regulation strategies, I think this is probably the golden egg of everything I'm giving you today. I would love your feedback this year. This is where we meet kids where they are. And when you are able to really take a look at the importance of breath and the importance of rhythm or texture or pressure or coolness, heat, alone time, giving that child another adult in the building to go to, art, listening to music, all of these in the blue, and you can see here through tapping, we use a Tibetan bowl where the kids listen to that sound, and they either, our younger kids put their hands on their vocal cords and they feel the vibration and they match that sound in the bowl. Our older students love it just to focus on that sound, and when they can't hear it any longer, they put their hand in the air we do a taking a brain sensory bath. And this is where, this is for the younger kids, where we're using pressure and touch and rhythm and, you know, creating a sensory repairing experience for them. So many of these are not COVID friendly. Many of them are. Many of these you can do online. I talked about trauma and tension releasing exercises. Here are a few of those today. Here's a foot roll. Everybody can sit at their seats and do the contracting of muscles and then the shaking it out. So we've got the foot roll, we've got the tiptoe raises, we've got stretches that the kids can do. Peaceful brushing is something that we did with the younger students, and everybody had their own set of brushes, but this may not be COVID friendly. These were for some of the younger students. But again, you can adopt and adapt these based on your, through the age group that you're working with. It's interesting. I was sharing yesterday that we have, and my graduate students, we talked about this over the summer in the certification course at Butler. Rocking is a very calming movement to people, and there's a neurobiological reason. And that when we rock, we actually activate opiate receptors down in the brainstem. And they produce that calming neurochemical that rocking produces. So when we rock, it activates the cerebellum, and the cerebellum then activates the brainstem. And inside the locus coeruleus, which is it's a large cell that is part of where our stress responses begin. We have serotonin receptors on that cell. We have opiate receptors. We have GABA receptors on that cell. But when you rock, you activate those. And it's just, you know, as Dr. Tom shared in the video, it's kind of like a little hit of heroin. It calms that brain. You've seen people who are grieving, rocking themselves, holding themselves. And that's a self-soothing mechanism. Pacing is rhythmic. Driving in your car, taking a drive is like rocking. Knitting, crocheting, needlepoint, some art forms, painting. All of those produce a calming because of the rhythmic piece of that. And so, yeah, you guys, I think you're gonna love this. And then after the sensory strategies, then we have the connection strategies. And then we look at the cortical strategies. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention. This is addressing discipline on the front end. So this is looking at discipline. And that's why in the MTSS framework, we have put this here. So let me open up a couple more of these before. Oh my gosh, I'm so excited. I forgot about this. So you've got this too. So I did this with presence learning when I did a webinar for them, and they actually were so excited that they included the bell work activities, the focused attention practices. So a lot of these are repetitive, but I just wanted to show you that you have just a whole buffet of things that you can do. I want to go into the community. I want to look at these racially cultural inclusive touch points. This is something that I just want us to think about. There's my website. So when we think about, and again, Reagan, my daughter and I were talking about this last night, how can we begin to incorporate every child, especially our Black and Brown children, their heritage into the school day, their traditions, their rituals? How can we help them to take some leadership in teaching us, about these topics? because we're looking at historical, embodied, institutional, structural trauma. And so I love these 26 mini films. I don't know if you guys have seen this. This was posted in the New York Times, but I would love for people to add to these resources. I mean, everybody is sharing so many incredible things, but one of the things that I want, it's not just about the content you share. And I wanna be very clear, and this framework, I really want this framework to grow into that. It's really about how we are going to give our students, all of our students, but how we're going to address anti-racism in an actionable way through embodied experiences. How can we create a culture in our buildings and in our grade levels and classrooms where kids can literally, even younger ones, can, like for a project, write a textbook, a historical piece that is much more accurate than what we have today. How can we create infographics and murals and use music and art and rhythm to share the heritage and to share the experiences that have been so compromised and ignored and actually, these implicit racial biases have been around. It's, again, we're not gonna get rid of it, but we've got to look at the structural pieces of that. So this area down here, I really would love for us to be thinking about how we can include our content and help our children even rewrite some of the content. I showed you earlier, these are the COVID resources. And then we have, I think it's gonna take me there and I didn't want it to. Let me go back. We also have this addiction and recovery piece because we know, and I am also looking.
Hey, I just read an unbelievable article in the Epic.
So this is Dr. Gabor Mate's connections between childhood trauma and addiction. And we also need to look at the racial disparities in addiction in our Black communities. We criminalize our Black community addiction challenges and we look at our white community addiction challenges as a health challenge. And so these are some of the things that I think that we collectively can begin to look at as we move through this framework. For those of you who weren't with me, let me pull up a couple of these brain-aligned bellwork activities because these are all, so this is a video that we did on who is your wise self. And you have this in, so you have this in the sensory, you have this in three other places in this template. But I have a YouTube channel where we have created morning meeting work where kids are using art and they're discussing and they're creating based on their experiences right off the bat. So that is something that I wanted to bring to your attention today too. And let me see if there's anything else before I, let me see what this is, crisis response. So this is just another resource out of LA, the National Center for, more resources for school crisis and bereavement. And again, we will be adding to these as we move along. And I want to leave time for questions, but I want to show you just a couple more slides real quickly. Oops, didn't mean that. One second. Sorry guys, I hit the wrong. So as we end today, I want to go just through just two more pieces of this. Kids in stress create in adults their feelings, and if not trained, the adults will mirror that behavior. And from Dr. Porges's work, our goal is to really help our students understand this metaphor of safety and connection, and that it's normal to move back and forth between safety and what feels dangerous to us. Many of us throughout the day will move into fight flight, that hyper arousal state. And then sometimes if we don't have somebody to co-regulate with us, we move into that life threat. I cannot emphasize this enough. This is a huge piece of this work, and our kids have an opportunity, as we do as adults, to really see how normal and natural it is to move between these social engagement, fight, flight, and shutdown. And as we know, the typical development shows a lot of molecular energy in cognition and developmental trauma. Look at all the energy spent in survival and regulation compared to trauma. This is a great graphic. I've already explained this today with using with kids, showing the fast pathway and the cortical pathway. So we call it the low road and the high road to fear. And please, please, as we end this today with questions and thoughts and ideas, our goal, our role in this new time is to really be that thermometer to be that thermostat and not that thermometer. And to co-regulate is to sit beside a child and helping them to drain off that negative emotion. And this is the crux of the new book. This is the core of what we've talked about today. Co-regulation versus coercive regulation. We have a new perspective here. There's new research to support that. We know how important it is to communicate non-verbally, and we know what that is going to be for our students. Your biggest, most challenging resistance will not come from students. It will come from your colleagues. Because if you do not understand the science of this work, it will look like you are rewarding negative behavior. And I cannot emphasize that enough. So as we end today, I encourage you, all of you that have shared the day with me, to give your students, we're going to be adding to the MTSS framework, but to give your staff the research, to share within the articles that I showed you this morning on the warm demander. And this weekend, I am going to be looking at adding more of these resources. In fact, you know what, Christy, I'll share this on Monday. That way Gabby and I can add some things this weekend so we don't have to keep. Does that sound like a good plan?
Yeah, that works for me.
Okay. Okay. So I want to make sure that we have plenty of time to answer questions.
As you're getting ready for those, I'm going to put in the chat box the PGP. This is what you will need to fill out. Make sure your email address is there. And then we did have one question about what would be the number one book that you would recommend for administrators in this, with this work?
Well, and again, I'm not trying to promote Michael McKnight's and my work, but I think Eyes Are Never Quiet is really a great book for administrators, because we really wrote, that was our most recent book, and a lot of school districts are using it as a school read. Mm-hmm. It includes the IDOE resources from social and emotional competencies. And we also address in detail the science beneath this work.
Awesome.
Yeah. And I'll go ahead and share this so you guys can see this. I wanted to pull this up anyway. Put this down.
As you're doing that, a lot of people agree that they love that book. But we had a question about how do you respond when students feel it's unfair? Why does Lisa get to go for a walk and we have to stay into the classroom? classroom or stay in the classroom. I would like more language to use in my classroom.
Well, so that's a really good question. And so I want to share with you, this is discipline on the front end, because I've heard it's not fair 1,000 times. And we have to sit down with our class before we have an eruption or disruption. And we have to really share in these procedures. You teach procedures at the beginning of the school year for the first 6 weeks. And I think as a class, we are going to have to sit down and talk about that. You know, I don't like the saying fair is not equal. I hate that. But everybody is going to get what they need in here. And so we talk about, some of us are going to need to walk to feel calm. Some of us are going to need to move away from the class for a few minutes to feel calm. One of the things that we always share with the students is that everybody's held accountable for their work. Just because you've got a practice or a strategy you're using, you know, you still have to complete the work. It's just going to have to be done at a different time. So one of the other things that I think is really important is we as a class take care of each other. When there is a disruption in the classroom, it's not just up to the teacher to start leading the way. I would love for every class member to have a responsibility when there is a disruption in the class, rather than sending the whole class out. And I know sometimes we have to do that. I wish we would do it less. I address that in the new book. But I think some of our students can be in charge of getting books out to read. Some kids can be in charge of turning off lights. Some students can be in charge of turning on some soft music. Another student can be in charge of getting another adult if that's needed. Everybody knows what they need to do ahead of time when a student has reached that point of no return. But when kids are complaining that's not fair, it's because they don't understand. It doesn't feel fair to them. I would validate that. I would say, you know what? I can't imagine how unfair this feels to you. Thank you for sharing your feelings. Let me explain to you, remember what we talked about at the beginning of the school year, because this is hard for us because we've never done it this way before. I hope that's helpful.
That's great. Someone put in there, fair is that everyone gets what they need, a great quote from somewhere that they post in their classroom. So just what you were saying, reiterating that we all need different things, right? It can take us back to the equity topic. I think as we start to explain that to our students right away, that's going to be really beneficial.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And all of this, you know, when we get to part two and part three, you know, as we add to this MTSS AEN framework, all of this is about discipline. Mm-hmm. And that's the beauty of this, is that, you know, again, I said it this morning, a trauma responsive school is a school that has changed their discipline protocol. So I think that's going to be really important for us as we move forward to really look at what, you know, contextually, what are we looking at here?
As adults, we have to come to the realization that students can and must understand this concept, bringing that science and logic behind the trauma-responsive discipline practices. True.
Yeah.
What other questions might you all have who are on?
Yeah, I would love, unmute yourself and ask away.
Can we see this morning session? So we have been recording the sessions, although we have to go through a really tedious process of closed captioning for that. So it will not be out until probably August. So yes, we'll work on that. And you can see that then. And then, or you can join us on the 14th for kind of a repeat sessions. And then a question, Lori, when and where will your new book be available?
So the new book is just kind of in the oven right now. And so it will be, you can pre-order it this fall, and then it will, probably you can pre-order it this fall, and then it will be available this winter. So we are giving the book away at the Butler University Educational Neuroscience Symposium to everyone who registers, and that's September 19th. And I'm really, really, I'll be sharing some little snippets from it all summer and fall.
Do you have a title yet for that?
Yeah, so it was what you just saw, connections over compliance, rewiring our perceptions of discipline.
In the chat, we had someone say, where do we find the wellness questions you suggested using with staff? I believe that survey's on your website, right, under the COVID-19?
Yeah, I think the survey's on the website. So if you go to the website, I think it's on there. Yeah, great question. And I'll send some documents. What we're going to be doing is, and I told Christy, this is really good for me. I learned from all of you today too. You're the first, this group today was the first time that I've been able to teach, you know, to really share the MTSS, because I've been waiting to do it with you guys. So we're going to be adding multiple links to those. So some of the things like the face masks, you know, and some of the other templates, you know, I'm going to be adding to it. So I'm really excited. It's just going to continue to evolve and develop and grow.
And would you say, Lori, the best place for them to go for your updates is your website?
Yeah, I think my website, and then just also follow me on social media, because I tweet out all the time, like when I have new articles or, you know, if I'm doing something in a classroom, and I'll just tweet out if I had a shitty day too, because,
right?
Yeah, I mean, I will say, oh my God, did I mess this up? So, but just Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, Facebook, and my author Facebook page is, you could follow that as How May I Serve You? And Instagram is lori.desitel, and LinkedIn, of course, and Twitter. So yeah, I'll be posting a lot.
Looks like we have one more question around, they weren't able to attend this morning. So where would you suggest a good resource around trauma-informed care, just to kind of deepen their understanding? I know we hear a lot of schools who use Jim's 4-Leader for that, in addition to Lori's work. Anybody else, Lori, that?
There are a couple of books that are really good too. They really kind of share disrupted childhood, how your biography becomes your biology, talks about the why of trauma. And I think that's really important. Unless you're wanting, Eyes Are Never Quiet takes the application of that. But I think Donna Jackson does a great job of sharing the why too, and what happens in the brain and body.
I have a question.
Yes.
Where would you start? So doing like MTSS training, like with staff that might be kind of resistant to this work, what's your starting point that gets buy-in from all parties?
Well, I think I wouldn't just even begin at saying, okay, we're going to do MTSS training. You know, I think that, you know, I would be sharing that, you know, you've attended professional development where we're really looking at how through MTSS, you know, we can address the brain and trauma and some of the behaviors of our most challenging kids. So, you know, I think I would be sharing, you know, some of the articles that I have posted in there, you know, why are we doing this? Maybe just little snippets of the research. And then, you know, and maybe talking about, you know, how I think starting with focused attention practices is a great way. You know, just small ways. So I think that's probably where I would begin. But share the research, that we get the buy-in in the science when we share that research.
Repeat, was the book Childhood Disrupted by
Childhood Disrupted by Donna Jackson. I don't know how to pronounce her last name. I always say Donna Jackson. Donna Jackson. Nakazawa, I think.
A lot of thank yous. I really think of this work, it's just for us, this is the DOE, as we've gone to support. I think what the biggest thing is, teachers have been looking for something like this, right? We've seen behaviors escalate, we've seen new behaviors, and we're trying to understand the why. Why is this happening? What is different? And I think that's a lot of what Lori's work does, is explain that. I appreciated the fact of you just saying that, you know, all the parents are doing the best that they can do right now, and the same for our students. And so how can we meet them in that space and really help provide them? And I think that's all Lori's work and those strategies. So definitely appreciate it and know it will be really needed as we come back from not only COVID, but the racial protest and the injustice and all that we just really need to be focused in on our students and families.
Yeah, absolutely. And also, again, I think you start with focusing on their brain states and not the behavior. And we'll be adding documents to that so kids can check in, not with behavioral check-ins, but brain state check-ins. And I shared some of those examples this morning for all of you. So Gabby and I are gonna meet tomorrow morning through Zoom, and we're gonna be going through and adding those documents. So I will send the updated MTSS AEN template to Christy early next week.
And as long as you guys, I know the link was shared from the one now, is if they still work in that document, it should upload, but we will, we have all your email if you fill it out the PGP survey, so we'll send that to you. A couple more things on here. Do you have forms for the kids to use when self-regulating, reteaching, practicing rather than disciplining? Something progressive or recommendation as to where to find for secondary students? If you don't mind, Lori, I'll say something really quick. I was at a middle school, and our teachers did a great job of buddy classrooms, and so they had think sheets and stations all in their classrooms, and the best part was the kids each practice. So if I'm feeling dysregulated, what might that look like? What might it feel like? What might that look like to my peers? And if I'm asked to, or if I ask to step out to go to the buddy room, what does that look like? And what do I do when I'm there? I can use fidgets. I can get a drink. I can write down my reflection. And so they practiced that when they were regulated, so that when they needed that space and that kind of flip over to just kind of walk away, that was already there provided for them. Lori and Dr. Oliver from Butler created tons of resources for us, and there are some think sheets within the SEL toolkit. And then I also see that the neuroscience, 100 days of neuroscience was shared in the chat box. This is Lori's baby, and it's been really helpful for, I think, a lot of our secondary math and science. We've seen it, them use it to replace bell work. So I don't know, Lori, if you want to share a little bit on that.
Yeah, so that is, right, it's just, again, it's a lot. And it actually is like 500 days of educational neuroscience, because you need, you can go back, you could take what's in one of those boxes and really spread it out for 3 or 4 days. But it's a great way just to build engagement and to teach students about their neuroanatomy. I want to show you, it's called the dual brain sheet. And I will, let me just share this. And I'm thinking if it's not in now, we're going to put it in. But I want to show this to you because. I just don't want you to leave without seeing this, because I really skipped some things this morning. I just didn't have time to go over. So let me.
Somebody also asked about MTSS documents. I will put the DOE ones, and then I'll put Lori's in there again.
Yeah. So this is something, I mean, take a picture of the slide if you want. You could literally create, think sheets are great, but, and I love Christy's, I love her idea about doing them when you're calm, so that kind of, gives you that pattern repetitive dress rehearsal. But I also feel that, we as teachers need to fill out these too, because number one, we're modeling for kids what we want to see, and we could always do it better. I would have done this as a mom. I would have, when Andrew, Sarah, and Reagan, when they were rough, I would have said, you know what, after we're calm, this is only to be filled out and addressed after we're calm. But, let's get, calm, and then we each fill this out separately. And even if you think that it was not your fault and that you did everything perfectly, this is a great way to talk about brain state. This is a great way to really come together. This morning I talked about rupture and repair, rupture and repair, rupture and repair. This is repairing. And this is Frank Klein at Abbott Elementary has recovery bags. And so those, when he and a student, or when a teacher and a student have to repair, they each get a bag. Frank fills them up in his office, and in the bags, a bottle of water, a post-it, and a pencil. And they sit down together, and they discuss their answers. You know, what is our challenge? What led up to it? How did we handle it together or apart? Could we have prevented it? And what are two adjustments that, you know, we'll make the next time? So that is, oh, and don't forget, you're gonna get this educator brain state too. And then I wanted to show you one more thing. And if you guys need to leave, that's absolutely fine. I just didn't get to everything. These are menus that we've created. We're still working on these, and these will eventually be added, but these are for touch points. So a lot of, you know, when you've got some really, really rough kids coming in, we might need to address, because the relationship piece too, and that's really hard when kids are relationship resistant. So what this is we, everybody gets a turn, but you know, a certain day we say, you know what, I wanna take your order today. And I may be out of some of it, but why don't you list two things that you would like? And so on the menu on the left is for a principal to give to staff. And then the menu on the right is for teachers to use with students. And you can change these up. These are just examples. But it's really cool because this is a great way to build connection and to actionalize touch points, which is the SEL spoke of MTSS and the behavioral spoke. And then we take their order. So they look at the menu and then we make our own, or we can, you know, order from Walmart or Amazon a guest check. And this is a great way that says to a child, I see you and I'm working for you today. You know, I want to serve you today. These are examples of touch points. You know, and please remember, I'm going the wrong way on this. You know, when you think about these touch points are actually addressing this beautiful interpersonal in-between space. And that happens moment by moment, as I said this morning. It can be through validation. It can be through taking your order. It can be through active responding, you know, when you're asking for details. It can be through greeting. I didn't share this today, and this is really important too. Traditional discipline says, when you are most unhappy, I'm not available to you. And the way I punish often mirrors your survival experiences. Isn't that true? I mean, traditional discipline isolates and sends away, and we think that for a behavior to change, the consequence must be painful or uncomfortable, and nothing could be farther from the truth. So I want us to think really about how our perceptions of safety override the environmental safety, because rupture and repair will always, always happen. So with that, I will end.
Okay, one more thing. We've had a lot of questions about access to your slides. So what we're sharing is the MTSS AEN resource guide. Some of the other things that Lori has pulled up are from other trainings. And so you're more than willing to, or welcome to use those resources or find them on her website, but we didn't have per se a slide deck for today that we could share. She's pulling from a variety of things. So I just wanted to clarify.
Yeah, and there's a lot of it on my website, and I will be adding some of these templates to the MTSS and AEN training. And if there's, you know, something very specific that you want right away, you know, just let me know too. And I'll stop and share. Here we go.
We had another question around. Good resource for brain states. They want more information around that. What would you recommend?
So this is something I'm going to send to all of you. This will be in the AEN. And if you want it beforehand, it's this one. And I went through this morning, and we have one for middle and high school that doesn't have the pictures. This is what we created at Abbott. And I think this replaces, this this is brain tracking. So this actually really helps the kids to look at and to objectify their, because kids have already labeled themselves. They know what their behaviors are. And sometimes it's easier just to be in the familiar than to change up. But this gets, this moves us away from behavior. So this is called brain tracking. You can use it once a day, twice a day, four times a day. You can add, we call these targeted challenges. So, oh, Christy, we have a video on this on your website.
The one that you did with the Butler Lab?
The one I did at the Butler Lab School with Frank Abbott.
Yes, so it's
under... Frank and Abbott, not Frank Abbott, Frank Klein and Abbott.
Yeah, it's under, I'll put it up there. It's what I was sharing earlier. It's on our DOE, under SEL in action. It's the last three things.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to find. I mean, you're right, it's SEL in action, but it's up there. So we have a video, and then a lot of schools are starting to roll this out, and we would have had more data if COVID hadn't happened, because it was all happening last year.
Yeah.
So we're going to start again, but there's a video to this, but this is a great, instead of check-in and check-outs, this would be, it would be really important. I see we're dwindling away. Everyone's leaving.
And it doesn't look like there's any other questions. I don't think I missed any. It will take us about a week to get you all your PGP certificates, but we will do that. Also, again, the recordings will come eventually. It'll take some time because we got to close caption all of everything we're all saying. So thank you guys for spending your Friday with us. Thank you, Lori, so much for your work.
Thank you.
I had a question earlier, the 14th. It will be very similar. So if you got what you need to get today, don't feel like you need to come back. We are just trying to offer additional supports. Oh, they had a question, Lori, about is there any info for the symposium in September?
Yeah, so if you Google Butler University Educational Neuroscience Symposium, it'll pop right up. And I can actually, I'll be posting those links on social media, but you just put Butler University Educational Neuroscience Symposium.
And that should pop up.
Yeah. And then we will start next fall, next school year, we'll start really promoting the next cohort to go through the next certification. We have 65 graduate students in this. So if you love this work, you want to delve into it, we have pediatricians taking this work. We have neuroscientists, clinicians, teachers, administrators, parents. It really is a great certification. It's 9 hours. I forgot to mention that this morning. And so if anyone is interested, just be thinking about it. It will start next summer in June.
Lori, they wanted to know if you could put your Instagram and Twitter within their chat box so that they could follow you. And then,
oh yeah.
A question about if it's a person or virtual. My guess would be our hope is to try to do person, but it's probably going to be virtual, I would assume, Butler September.
Oh, are you talking about the symposium?
Yes.
Yes, it's virtual. And okay. Yeah, and I don't know. There's my Instagram, and Twitter is, let's see.
I think you're just sending to somebody personally. We can't see.
Oh, shoot.
Okay. I know. I do it too.
Dang it. Okay, here. This is really easy. Just everybody take a picture of this.
Is it all right to do it orally after we close?
I'm sorry. Say that again.
I think they just went off mute.
Okay. Here is my contact information. So take a picture of this because it'll take me forever.
And it looks like, yeah, so Amy, just, you have another question, so feel free to let us know what that is, and then we'll wrap up.
So there's my Butler email, Twitter, website, Instagram, LinkedIn, and the Facebook. So
awesome.
Yeah, please.
Rebecca got the screenshot that she was on that ask. So, Amy, if you're still on and want to ask your question, if not, we'll wrap up. Oh, asking for clarification for reading expression from eyes up. Can I unmute? Yeah, please unmute yourself.
Thank you so much. Can you hear me all right?
Yes,
yes, I can. Yes.
Thank you so much. When I was listening to the part about when the children are wearing masks or other students, adults, focusing on, you know, paying attention to expression because we can see from the eyes up still. Mm-hmm. I'm feeling like I might have misunderstood you. So clarification, no. When we use, usually when we're not wearing a mask, we always look at the whole face. Mm-hmm. So what were you, tell me once more what you were saying about eyes up.
So, absolutely. So this is Stephen Porges's research, Dr. Stephen Porges, and it's part of the polyvagal theory. And so what he has discovered is the connection between our orbito eye muscles.
Mute while I listen.
Okay, so he's found the connection between eye muscles and those inner ear muscles and our vocal expression. And also looking at how brain and body communicate. So we know, and it's interesting because I think of those sayings, the eyes are the windows to the soul. And I think there are a couple of others with the eyes, but we know that we really are reading people nonverbally through looking at eyes along with gestures and postures. But the good news about masks is that we really can tell somebody's facial expression, even masked, through from the eyes up.
Great. Well, thanks again, everybody. We're gonna go ahead and wrap it up here. We'll be sending you your PGP and the recordings once we have them, so hang tight. If you have any specific questions about resources that Lori shared, feel free. She gave you her info to share that, and they'll get that going. Have a great weekend.
Thanks, you guys.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lori.
Thank you so
much.
Thank
you.
Oh my gosh, Christy, I have so many tabs up. Thank you.